Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Anthony Lamort. I was the organist and choir director here more years ago than I'd like to remember. Very, very good years, and this church will always have a fond place, a more than fond place, a place of love in my mind and heart. This evening, I have prepared a program for you. I think this was originally supposed to happen around the time of the celebration of the birth of Johann Sebastian Bach, but then lots of other things happened, and here we are. Here we are, the 21st of August, on the end, I hope, of COVID season. So the first part of the program is music of Bach, specifically choral preludes from the Neumeister collection. This has kind of been my project for the last few months, so some of these are actually new works to me. They're all based on Lutheran chorales. I will play, oh, I don't know, about a half dozen of those or so. They're all very brief. And then we'll move on to a different composer that I'll tell you about if you're all still here. I hope that this will be edifying and at least some of the joy for you. Thank you so much again for being here. Thank you. Thank you, you're very kind. We're going to shift over to a few pieces by an individual who may have had one of the worst jobs in the world. Not so much job, but perhaps just positioning. The composer is Johann Gottfried Walther, and he had the unenviable position of being Johann Sebastian Bach's less famous cousin. I want you to just take a moment to imagine such a fate. Johann Walther's music is not entirely unknown. It is known by organ music aficionados and organists and so forth, which some could argue means it's entirely unknown. But at any rate, I have been a champion of Walther's music, I suppose, being always one who relates to the underdog, I guess. So a few pieces by Walther, and I actually believe he does live up to his cousin, and I hope you will think so as well. composer Dietrich Buxtehude to put it in a proper time frame. Buxtehude was an aged man when Bach was a young man, and the story goes that such was the fame of Buxtehude, and such was the passion of the young J.S. Bach for music, that J.S. Bach decided one fine morning to walk all the way to where Buxtehude lived, some 250 kilometers or so. So he kind of went AWOL from his church position. Those of you who know me from the old days know I probably did some crazy things in my tenure as a church musician, but never quite so crazy as to go AWOL and walk 250 kilometers. But then again, we can't all be Bach either. So the story continues that the young Bach was very, very impressed by the elder Dietrich Buxtehude, and in fact was hugely influential on his music. The elder Buxtehude was also impressed by the young Bach, so much so that he wanted him to stay there and be appointed as his successor, as Kapellmeister of Marieskirche. Bach would have considered that, but there was a catch to this, along with the position. The proviso was that Bach would have to marry Dietrich's daughter. There are so many things I could say here, none of them good. So I guess what I'll just say is that had they hit it off better, musical history would have been very, very different. It's interesting to note, by the way, that the Dietrich Buxtehude apparently had tried the same thing on George Friedrich Handel just a little bit earlier. So I don't know what was with the young Miss Buxtehude, but I'm sure she found the right person eventually. Set of choral variations by Buxtehude. Thank you. Thank you. We're going to take a break from the High Baroque for just a moment before we go to our next real composer. And I'm going to, just because I used to do this all the time, many years ago, interpose a composition of my own. It is from a series of pieces that I wrote while I was traversing the intercoastal waterway from the New York City harbor down to Melbourne, Florida. I wrote a series of impressionistic pieces, kind of I guess describing the journey. And this is one of those pieces, a series of 50 of them, actually. It was a long trip. At any rate, they all have grand titles, you know. They all have wonderful titles, things like Entry into the Kohansi and wonderful energetic sailing titles, all except for this one, which is titled Ode to a Little Yellow Bug. That's right, Little Yellow Bug. If you want to know the story of the piece, I'll tell you later. Occasionally, when I've played this piece in performances, I try to tell a story, but it always winds up with me devolving into tears, which is not a good look for a 6'4", 300-pound man to start blubbering in the middle of his own recital. So I won't tell you the story, I'll just play the music. And I don't actually have to do anything now because it's all been recorded. And what else can I tell you about this? I kind of went kicking and screaming into the electronic revolution. I'm really a man from the 17th century. But nonetheless, once I found my way into the electronic world, I guess, well, in the words of someone far more renowned and more deserving, here I stand. Thank you. Thank you for your indulgence. We're going to move on to a composer, the last composer for our evening's offering, a personal favorite of mine, Johann Pietus von Sweelinck. It took a whole graduate semester, by the way, just to learn how to pronounce that name. I still don't always get it 100% right. Two pieces we'll close out our evening with by Sweelinck. The first is based on a chorale that translates to "O God, look down from heaven above," and of course that's a hymn from all the way back to the 16th century, actually. Not one that's all that popular today, so I would play the tune for you, but probably it would be unrecognizable. And it's not necessarily what's important. Anyway, what is important is that this is, when Sweelinck was writing, it was very interesting, a couple of facts about him. He spent his entire life as the Kapellmeister of the Udkerke in Amsterdam, and he managed to survive in that position through Roman Catholic, Lutheran, and Reformed regimes in Amsterdam. And the church went with those different regimes, and yet there he remained. Tumultuous times, to say the least. So the hymn, "O God, Look Down from Heaven Above," I'm sure was apropos to him, as it is undoubtedly in our day today. So I pray that this music will, if nothing else, be prayerful for you. In moments of it, will be other moments of it, maybe more boisterous, but I'll let you decide that. Sweelinck, during his life, was a premier reformer in the days when organists were the kind of rock stars of the day. Kind of hard to imagine that, but that was the reality. And he managed to earn himself two nicknames, which I'm pretty sure he liked very much. One was the Orpheus of Amsterdam, and the other was the maker and breaker of organists, and maybe towards the end of the second piece you'll understand why that is. Okay, so two pieces by Sweelinck.